So up next, we have another artist here, Leanne, Christie. She's a painter, and her production is of Death Masks, the Vancouver Viaducts and Complexity. So with this, Ms. Christie, if you want to come up here and show us more about your work, we're very happy to have you here with us today. Folks, you're in store for another set of fantastic renditions from this wonderful artist. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. I believe I've got, I think, a two-hour slot. So we can all settle in. I've got my notes over here ready to go. So thank you very much. It's nice to see everybody. And I'm very, very excited about introducing this work to you. I will go into various steps of my process in terms of thinking about the pieces and actually explain why I've called the series Death Mask. But for now, I think the best thing to start with is to show you each painting, and there's currently three pieces on display at the moment. The one at the end is not a completed piece. We're probably about 60-70% there, but there's still a bit of dialogue that needs to happen with it. There is a piece missing, which is the second piece. But each painting so far, minus the one at the end, obviously I'm still in process, has got a video which accompanies it. Because the whole point with painting is to have it as a form of communication, it's not to alienate people. So part of my video process is to add another layer of the storytelling to it. So I'm going to start off just by showing you the first video that goes with this middle painting over here, and then we can get onto the little train of thought that leads through the paintings, and hopefully at the end it'll make sense why we've actually called them.
Yeah. During the 1930s and 1940s, this was a great community to grow up in. Strathcona has always had a multicultural makeup, which included Jewish families, Japanese families, Chinese, Italians, and people of African descent.
About the viaducts, and this is one of the reasons why they made sense as a particular topic for the series of paintings. Your passage of relationship comes from your experiences and your input that you have through shared community experiences and individual experiences. What are the viaducts? There have been so many things. They're the political manifestations, they're the cultural, social, racial, economic, urban dreams that are actually there as part of our landscape. And in many ways, I'm from South Africa, and we were so surrounded by so many political monuments for such a long period of time. And every time a political monument was toppled, it was something meaningful. And with the viaducts, it is the only political monument that I can see in Vancouver. My passage into exploring the viaducts is through complexity. One of the things I think about as an urban painter, as an urban oil painter, are the spaces that I enjoy painting within the city. What's interesting about the spaces that I want to linger in? What's interesting about the spaces that I actually want to encapture? What is it that excites my imagination, excites my emotions, excites my creativity, and what is it that excites the people around me? And what is it about the spaces that I can't wait to leave? The spaces that leave me feeling with a sense of disease, that I want to actually exit from. And one of the things that I've realized about the spaces that engage me are these are the spaces that are filled with complexity. And in looking at complexity, one of the things I've started to realize about complexity is complexity comes from a layering of time and a layering of experiences or relationship. It's a relationship that we have with each other within those spaces, and it's also our relationship that we have with the actual physical environment around us. So in looking at complexity, looking at my urban environment, thinking about the viaducts, and trying to understand, well, fair enough, but what does this mean to you as a painter? I've started thinking about how to develop complexity within the work itself, because if that's the magic ingredient that excites our humanity, excites our engagement, excites our visions for the future, how do I instill complexity into a painting? And one of the things that I've had a look at, because complexity is basically, as I've been trying to understand and explain in the video, it's time plus relationships. It's giving people a canvas, creating a safe space so that time can act, and then relationships can act to create a new space that describes our community and our culture. So looking at time within a painting, it's like, oh, this is great, I'm actually an oil painter. And oil paint is the perfect vehicle to infuse time into a painting. Sure, we can slow down the entire process, and oil takes a very long time to dry, so you really are able to slow down the process and nurture out the character of a painting. But more than that, more than slowing it down and making it into another technique, coming back to the truth about complexity and thinking about, for example, a Bittner, who will spend time actually infusing time as an ingredient into his wine, to bring out the depth of flavor, to bring out the clarity, to bring out character into his wines. And you look at a chef who will also use thyme as an actual ingredient in the cooking process to bring out a personality to the food that he's producing for you. So in thinking about that, I was looking at my materials and trying to understand how, yes, I've got pigments, I've got other aspects, like we've got paintbrush strokes, we've got perspective. There's so many tools that you have as a painter, but how do you actually then start harnessing the power of time, infusing it into the painting in such a way that it acts on the painting in the same way that a Bittner or a chef acts upon the painting? So that brought me back to the viaducts, this big, long loop. Great, I'm getting a little bit further along in complexity and understanding why it's important to develop complexity for human beings. But then I'm looking again at these viaducts and trying to understand why I should bring complexity into the viaducts. And the reason is because the viaducts are so complex. For every single person in this room, each person has their unique experience and their own personal view of the future plans for the viaducts. But then I was trying to think, what is complexity? What is the difference between complex and complicated? And in looking at complexity, never Google complexity. It'll take you hours and hours. In fact, the problem thing is probably going to take years of your life to get to the bottom of complexity, because every single field seems to have their own analysis of complexity, and it's a huge topic. So what I've done is I've just taken it, boiled it down to the most basic elements, complexity being a system which is made up of individual parts which have individual relationships acting upon the other parts within the system. So what does it basically mean? It basically means that you take away one of these parts and the system will break. But it's practically impossible to figure out what broke the system and how to redeem the system and how to remedy the system, because it's far too complex the way the relationships all interact, which is very different to complicated. Complicated becomes complicated. And you can go very far down that road, but at the end of the day, there's a linear relationship that happens between all the parts within the system. And it's fairly easy, depending on how complicated it is, to understand what broke and to fix what actually broke within the system. So coming back to this body of works, why have I called it death marks? Looking at complexity, perfect vehicle to explore complexity. Time, perfect vehicle to explore time. But what's important about a death mask is that a death mask, again, in different cultures and different periods of time, has had different meanings. But when I've approached death mask, I've looked at it from the aspect of an actual death mask, which is created, a clay impression of someone's face at the moment of passing or shortly thereafter. The Vancouver Viaducts are in their final throes. They are dying. And this is the only moment I will have as a painter to throw my clay onto them and capture something of what it feels for us as human beings living alongside these structures. Who were they? What are they? Because at some times they've been murderers, at other times they've been a bully. At some times they've been protectors, sometimes they've been communists, sometimes they've been capitalists, sometimes they've been a friend, sometimes they've been a foe, and sometimes they've been orphans. So to capture these dying throes that we can only now experience on this death mask, what did it mean to the past, what does it mean to the present, and what is it bringing into the future? So with the death mask, I'm not the person that's going to stand up here and give you a critique on the city's plans, on what they intend to do with the viaducts. I've read all the plans, but I'm not specialized enough, educated enough to actually give any kind of critique on it. That's not what I'm doing with this series. I don't have an agenda with this series. All I'm doing is, as a human being, trying to understand how complexity can be brought into a painting through capturing what it is about these structures, these monuments that we have, the great canyon that exists within our city. What does it mean? What does it feel to actually be living here alongside them? So looking at these paintings, the first one over here, we've got time infused into this painting. With this piece, and I'm going to step away from the microphone and just quickly point out something. These areas over here, when you come into this painting, you'll notice that there's some areas that are very densely built up and other areas where you can actually see the canvas. And as you probably saw in the video, at various points through the painting, I intentionally, even when the painting was at a point where realistically we could have put a lovely tick after it, it didn't have the secret ingredients of complexity. Time hadn't acted upon it. So what I did is I intentionally built up the piece and then broke it down again. Built it up, broke it down again. Built it up, broke it down again. And in a very silly way, the area that I just pointed out to you, that was an area and a space in time when David Bowie was alive. I was painting this painting in January last year. The final pieces, the white sections that are very thick, very strong, thin pasto, that's part of a world where David Bowie is no longer alive. So it's just an interesting thing to play with in one's mind when one's thinking about infusing time into a painting, that with an oil painting you really do have the luxury of building different layers which are not based on technique, they're based on human response to the painting, but there is time infused into the painting. The thing about this time that I've infused into the painting, it is powerful, but it's static. It only goes to a certain point. And as I said, coming back to the idea of complexity, thinking about my urban environment, what is it about the spaces I enjoy? What is it about the spaces I don't enjoy? we have time, and then we have relationship. So in this painting here, although I've always approached the paintings and the brushstrokes of all my works are always infused with intention, there is never a single piece in my paintings that has been left. There is never a moment in the painting that's there by default. Every single choice that I make in the painting is a conscious choice. It doesn't matter how small the piece is, how large the piece is, every element will be there. Every element is there for an intention, because what I'm doing is I'm not actually painting, I'm communicating to you. And so thinking about this, thinking about what I already do in my process, thinking about there's a static element of time, we have to then start thinking about how to bring time into a painting as an active ingredient. How to have time act on a painting in a way that's non-destructive. So looking at the second image, which we don't have here this evening. It's a photograph. The second painting was having a look at the skate plaza underneath the Vancouver Viaducts. The skate plaza has become the lounge for so many of the children in the city. And when one actually starts investigating the history of the skate plaza, you actually start seeing how many events happen there, how much of a large, reputable social gathering space it is. But more than that, it's become a cathedral. It's a cathedral to skateboarding. It's become a safe space for young people and some middle-aged people to be in the city. So this is the second painting in the series. This is just simply called the plaza, and it's approximately this size over here. But in working with this particular painting, I started understanding that what I'm already doing in the paint in terms of handling my brushstroke to communicate to the viewer that intentionality in the work started happening in this piece when I shared it with people, and I could see that people were bringing in each and every single one of their own stories. So then what we've realized is the secret to bringing complexity into the painting is not only having time, but also having relationship. And what starts happening when you use time as an active ingredient in the painting is you start saying to your viewer and start saying to you, this is not for you to consume. These paintings are not for you to sit back, relax, and enjoy. These paintings are inviting you to interact with them. And a way of encouraging you to interact is never to give you so much that you can sit down, relax, and have your mind shut off so you stop thinking. It's to give you just enough ambiguity in the painting that it feels comfortable to engage, and at the same time, you've been welcome to engage, because that's what we want to do with complexity, is we want to create safe spaces people to interact and for time to make its mark. Moving on to this piece over here then, which is the third painting in the series, it's a little hard potentially to actually recognize the specific location of it. The name of this painting, which I won't go exactly into detail because it's a fairly lengthy name, it's coordinates. I just call it simply 49 degrees. The coordinates are written over there on the painting. And the reason why I've put the coordinates onto that painting, and this is the first painting that I've redacted, but the reason why you have coordinates on that painting is because that specific street pole over there has had so much meaning to it. This is as the viaducts come out of town, and I always get my roads prior. We're there, prior? As they join up as prior. And what often has happened in the history of the viaducts is people coming out of town will potentially you're going a little too fast, hit that corner without realizing the sharpness of the corner, lose control of their vehicles, and here we have that street lamp which is perfectly placed for the cars to interact with. So, so many people have lost their lives there, but at the same time, so many people's lives have been enriched there. Because at one point in time, there were houses all along that street. In the video that I'll show at the end of this little talk, you'll see I've superimposed a map which has Hogan's Alley on it and takes up that block. These were homes. This was somebody's back garden. But we forgot about that. Potentially not the people in this room, but the people in Vancouver have forgotten that these were once homes. There were people living here, there were people born here, there were dramas here, people fell in love here, people got married here. We forgot that. And just as when these viaducts are going to come down, we're going to forget the people whose lives were impacted and altered forever because they lost their lives on this corner. I won't attempt to pronounce a gentleman's name, but the young student from Zambia who lost his life there in 2013 was one of the images that I kept on my studio wall to remind me to remember, because there's something that's worse than forgetting, and it's actually forgetting to remember. And that's why I've redacted this painting, because we are forgetting to remember, and when the viaducts come down, we'll forget to remember even more of all the stories that have gone in there. Is this going to be a patch of grass, or potentially just a condo building? And who will even stop twice to think about the lives that were changed and what stories are actually there on this corner? Heading into the last painting just over there, and as I said, the last painting is approximately 60% finished, although that's a fairly random number because I never know when the paintings are finished. Just as I'm inviting you to have a relationship and to bring all of your experiences and to trigger you that this is a engaging experience, this is an interactive experience, I'm relying on you to finish my paintings for me. I never know when a painting says to me, Leanne, we're done. The thing about this painting is that before I actually tore the painting, it was done. It was one of the most successful, most powerful pieces that I have painted, and I was giving myself a big tap on my back, pulled out my penknife and was hesitating, but I knew what I wanted to do to take this painting to the next level, and as a result, it's no longer finished because the tear in the side of the painting has interacted with the painting in a way that I couldn't predict. And now I need to incorporate that tear into the painting in order to have the internal balance that each and every single painting has to make it into a successful piece. This area over here, you can probably see there's a little house in the background. This is the section, if you're standing over here looking at downtown, you turn around and behind you, this is a little patch of land that's just behind you. And just as there was once a thriving community there, I wouldn't necessarily say it's a thriving community there, but there are people that live there today. For them, the name of this painting is Home, because this is their home still today. They are there, and they're another community that living in the city who potentially doesn't have a strong political voice and isn't able to influence the future and to have any control or say over their lives. But again, I'm not here to make any political statements or to have an agenda. It's just the way I interact when I'm in that space. So with this painting, as with the plaza, I've also tried to capture that enclosed feeling, to try to get the feeling of what it means to be home. Home is that safe space. Home is that place where you can relax and be yourself. Home is where you don't have to put on any pretenses for anybody else. Home is a cocoon that's there for you. And that's what the viaducts are at the moment in this particular area. That's what it feels to be a human being alongside the viaducts, is it does create a cocoon. A cocoon created out of debris, cocoon created out of boxes, cocoons created out of torn rags, but there is a community that does live between the viaducts. I'm going to finish off the talk today just with the final little video which accompanies this painting over here, and thank you very much.
I'm amazed that more people are not obsessed with streets and roadscapes. They're the wildest part of the city. It's where we carry out our humanness. It's where the drama of our humanity occurs. It's we interact with other people, we understand what we hold dear as a city, and it's a place where so many of us find our exits, a place where so many of us die. It's one of the things, when I'm looking at the viaducts and recording the death mask of these structures, is to capture how it feels to be a human being interacting with these structures. It's not about how the structures look, it's about the feeling of these structures. And every single time I looked at this corner, which is just that little bend as the viaducts join Prior Street as you're traveling east out of the city, so many accidents have occurred there, so many people have passed away there, and more than that, more than what is happening there today, and my obsession with the roadscape today, is that that was once part of False Creek. When you look at the photographs from the turn of the century, it's a swampy, water-looking area, and then you have a look at the area and the photographs and the plans from before the viaducts were there, and it was this thriving community, Hogan's Alley, and where people die on that little corner as they lose control of their vehicles were yards, were areas where people were actually living. And all of these memories are slowly disappearing as the complexity of the city develops, or the redaction of the city carries on. And so when I was looking at recording this particular corner, it was about recording the human drama that has taken place, and the human drama that we will forget to even think about in probably 2 years' time when these viaducts have gone down and something else is there, and it continues into the future, continues into its new life. This painting is about remembering. It's the death mask of that corner, so that when we forget to think about what was here, this will hopefully trigger a little something.
Something that for me is really, really important as we think about this notion of Africa and Africans and African ways of knowing and being in the world. So you brought up this notion of epistemologies, which is essentially the ways of knowing in the world, the different worldviews, and ontologies, which is the ways of being in the world, and this idea of man-made or human-made structures as beings was so fascinating. And so I think what you brought forward was the idea of this viaduct as being. And then what does bringing down this viaduct do beyond it just being collapsed and something being rebuilt? What is lost in the process of us tearing down a viaduct, even if the noble cause is to resurrect the memories of those, to recreate a community that was once there, but what's lost along that process? And I think you really, really, really made it clear that this notion of deathness was really about the notion of what was lost in terms of human lives as a result of this viaduct being. But preceding that was what was lost in terms of the relationships, the people that existed, and then what was lost when the indigenous peoples of the land were also moved. And so it creates all these entanglements, if I may, in terms of complexities of relationships and what time does to it. And that question of the worst thing you can do is to forget to remember really stuck with me. So hopefully as we move forward in the day in these discussions and are thinking about this reshaping of the city, we don't forget to remember what was once there. And I think Leanne did a phenomenal job of encouraging us, if not challenging us, to do that.